This Week in Virology, the podcast about viruses, the kind that make you sick.
Time for This Week in Virology. This is a special episode recorded on July 11th, 2014. Hey everybody, I'm Vincent Racaniello, and you are listening to TWiV, the podcast all about viruses. I'm back in Australia today. Well, I never left since the last podcast. I'm in Geelong, which is a town south of Melbourne, and my special guest today is Linfa Wang.
Hi, Vincent.
Welcome to TWiV.
Yeah, welcome you to Geelong.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's a long way to come.
This is the Australian Animal Health Laboratory.
Yes.
It's also known as AL, right?
Yeah, AL is the acronym. That's right, yeah.
And it is a lab of the CSIRO.
Yeah, part of the CSIRO. And CSIRO stands for the Commonwealth Science and Industry Research Organization. So this is really the largest research body in Australia.
Would you say it's the NIH equivalent of Australia?
Only that it does not do the human health. So everything else, yeah, it's like NIH, okay. It's a national agency, but it does everything except the human health.
It does animal health, right?
Animal health, you know, go from mathematics to information technology, nanotechnology, material science. We even have a division for mining industry, you know, so it's okay. A very applied, you know, yeah.
So you were kind enough to invite me to come visit because I'm here for the ASM, Australian Society for Microbiology meeting. And a long time ago, you asked me to visit. Yeah. This is quite a nice lab here. And so I want to talk a little bit about it. But first, I want to talk about you and where you were brought up and educated.
Yeah, so my career path sort of is very different from you and other people, you know. I grew up sort of in Shanghai and in the communist China. At that time, you know, university was shut down, school was shut down. So my dream was become an engineer, really. Oh. And then after Cultural Revolution, the universe restarted. And I put all my preference in sort of engineer school. And in China, that's like a second tier university.
Okay.
But somehow I performed myself. So my score went to the first tier, but I did not have any preference. So this guy just made a decision, said, you go to that university, East China Normal University, and you study biology, you know.
You're kidding.
Yeah. So, you know, but I really, you know, didn't like biology. So I tried to stay away, as far away from living things.
Yeah.
So I chose biochemistry.
Okay.
So then I did a biochemistry, and then I was fortunate enough that when I finished the university, you know, scholarship became available. So I got the first scholarship of the whole university, went to UC Davis, did my PhD in biochemistry and molecular biology.
Whose lab were you working with?
Yeah, it's Roy Doy, so who is a bacillus subtilis, you know, gene regulation and a sigma factor promoter. So in those days, 82, it was really hot.
Yeah, sure.
You know, because E. coli at that time, we thought just one sigma factor. And already we knew in bacillus, they have a sort of sporulation. So it's like the simplest form of differentiation.
Right.
So we had a lot of fun to study minor sigma factors and promoter switching during that gene regulation. So
people still study sporulation.
That's right.
We have a colleague at Columbia who works on bacillus subtilis sporulation.
You know,
still we don't understand what triggers.
Yeah, and the Rich Rosick at Harvard was really famous in
Absolutely.
That area. You know.
So where did you go after your PhD?
Yeah, so again, you know, accidentally somebody saw I did my postdoc with Roy Doy because my wife was a gene master in UC Davis,
okay.
So I decided to stay on. And then sort of a friend of mine, you know, a Chinese friend in Australia, sent a CV to a department head in biochemistry, Monash University, and then without even me applying, they offered me the job. So that's how I came to Australia,
nice.
You know. So
what city was that in?
Melbourne. So
Melbourne.
It's the Monash University. And so I spent 18 months in Monash, and then I thought the job advertisement in this the CSIRO, Australian Animal Health Laboratory. So
okay.
I thought, you know, because I didn't like biology, I really studied biochemistry and molecular biology, but I think you know, you have to make a decision whether you apply to human health, animal health, or plant health. Mm-hmm. And then at that time, I already was in Australia, and animal health is really important in this country. And as you have seen, this facility, you know, it's just fantastic. So when I was offered a sort of indefinite job, then I took it. So I came here in 1990.
And when you came here, that's when you started working on viruses.
That's right.
You hadn't done anything before that.
Well, interestingly, my career is all fate, because before I left UC Davis, you know, and the vet school in UC Davis started working on blue tongue virus.
Okay, blue tongue, right.
So that was like, you know, 85, 86. So cloning is still something that some people can do, other people will never get to work. So I was very good at cloning. So the vet school came to my professor, said, we want to clone two blue tongue genes, and can you help? And my professor said, you know, you should ask Linfa to do it before he leaves. And so I did a two cloning, two expressions. I have two papers in blue tongue virus I never thought would be useful. But when I was applied a job to come to this laboratory, they were working on blue tongue virus.
Okay.
So I had a two paper on blue tongue virus. So I don't say, I did not consider that as a track record, but at least I have done some molecular virology work before. But I know I had no formal training in virology before I came here.
So you taught yourself?
Oh, I learned from a very good mentor, Brian Eaton. You know, he's a very good virologist. So, you know, he taught me all the, but I still classify myself as a molecular virologist, you know, the classic virologist. Yeah.
Now, not only do you have a position here, you have a position in Singapore as well. How did that come about?
Yeah, so again, you know, it's the fate sort of, you know, about 3 years ago, I was headhunted. You know, people really says, you know, they're looking for a new director of the Emerging Infectious Disease Program of Duke NUS Graduate Medical School. And initially, I thought, no, I won't leave Australia. But after interview there, I found it's very impressive. So it's a joint venture, sort of. It's an investment by the Singapore government, but it's a huge contribution from Duke Medical School. Mm-hmm. It's really trained sort of new generation of clinicians in Singapore so that they will have a research culture.
Right.
So Singapore traditionally has this, you know, a medical school is the British system, undergraduate med, whereas the Duke model is the US. So they try to really diversify that. And then they have a pretty sort of good emerging infectious disease program. And the founding director is Duane Gubler, you know, right. So he's a pioneer in dengue research. Yeah.
So do you do research there as well?
Yes.
So you have a lab, a separate lab there?
Yeah. So I have, I try to do a smaller group than here. Here and at the peak, we had 30 people here to work from, you know, molecular virology all the way to BSF-4 pathogenesis. So in Singapore, because we don't have a BSF-4, so, but we're building a ABSS-3. So I have, you know, I took the director job from July 1st, and I spent 70% time there and 30% time here in Australia. And so I tried to build a smaller group, but you know, looks like people really love this area, so I already have a group of 10 people there.
Right, so you go back and forth between here and Singapore. You don't have to go to Duke very often, right?
Twice a year. So I was at Duke just last 2 weeks ago.
You don't have a lab there, do you?
I don't have a lab.
That it's would be mainly, really...
No, it's impossible. even I think if this joint appointment was, if it was the Durham campus, I could not do it. Because flying to you know, North Carolina and Australia is too much. With Singapore and Melbourne, direct flight, and you know, 2 to 3 hours difference, you know, in terms of time zone. So it's much more manageable.
So today I got the opportunity to tour the facility. You have a BSL-3 and BSL-4. Here it's called PC-3 and 4, right?
PC-3, I think, is more for the buildings. I think we call ourselves a BSL, because PC is for engineer terminology. For biological operation, I think it's a BSL.
I toured this very, it's a huge concrete structure with both 3 and 4.
Yeah.
You can work on animals of all different sizes here. And why don't you tell us just briefly the history of this building? It's very interesting.
Yeah, so the building really was established, or the design started in the 70s and took 10 years to design and build it. Mm-hmm. And the operation started in 1985. It's really sort of under the sort of context of Australia being a very clean, you know, an island country. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Australians' animal health used to, you know, the commodity market used to really be very big, and somebody says it's like half the GDP.
I see.
You know, okay. So, and then at that time, Australian dollar is worth like $1.40 US. So that, you know, it's a rich country with a lot of money. And so visionary scientists, you know, decide to say we should protect this clean environment and protect our livestock industry. So if we can build a high containment facility, so we can study this nasty virus we call exotic viruses.
Such as, what were the exotic viruses?
Foot and mouth disease virus was the number one.
But you didn't have foot and mouth here in Australia,
right? That's the irony of this whole thing, is this building was built mainly to fight FMDV, but I think the Farmers Federation really was worried about import live virus. So we have enacted the materials, so we can do all other stuff, but we don't have the live virus. So we have to rely on our collaborators, you know, in Vietnam, in Thailand, to do the vaccine trials and things like that.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So an animal facility is mainly meant to protect wildlife outside.
Yeah.
Not the people inside the lab.
Yeah, livestock mainly. At that time, it was not even wildlife. It's the livestock industry. Sheep,
sure.
Cattle, pigs,
exactly,
chickens.
Right.
Yeah.
So I've been to Plum Island, which is...
It's our sister laboratory.
Yeah, sort of the same idea. There, you go in.
Yeah.
And you change clothing, but then on the way out you shower because you don't want to bring any viruses out.
That's right.
And that's different from, say, a BSL lab where you're using human pathogens where you don't have to shower on the way out.
Yeah.
But here you do both, so you have to shower.
That's right. So the lab was built mainly to protect the environment than the operator, because we were dealing mainly with, as you say, animal pathogens. So showering, make sure no pathogen comes out. But that changed, of course, in 1994 when Hendra virus emerged in Australia. So now we sort of, at least my group mainly is doing research on zoonotic pathogens, although they originate from animal, but they're highly lethal to human as well.
So the outbreak of Hendra, which was, the virus was isolated here, first time. What was
That's
the name of the scientist?
Yeah, Paul Selig, you met at lunchtime. So he was the virologist, first isolated virus. And interestingly, all important samples come to this laboratory on Friday afternoon, Friday night. But we have a 24-hour shift system if we have sample really important.
Okay.
Yeah, so he inoculated on Friday night, and by Monday he saw CPE already.
Were you here at the time?
I was here, but I was not working in that sort
laboratory.
So
at that time it was just BSL-3.
Yeah.
And then after a while, you told me that Hendra was then upgraded to BSL-4, right?
Yeah, and then Tom Kaizak from CDC came here to help us to really commission the BSL-4 first time, basically.
So that involves taking some of the BSL-3 space and converting it for 4, which involves chemical showers and spacesuits.
That's the major difference, because operators had to wear a spacesuit now,
So I'll summarize my experience. I went in and I took my clothes off, then went into another room, put clothes on, and then walked into the facility. And if I were going to go in the 4, I would then have to do another clothing change and put spacesuit on.
That's right.
Then coming out of the 4, you take a chemical shower.
Yeah.
And you take off those underclothes, put on the other clothes that you had on before, and then walk to the...
No, you have to do another normal shower first before you come out.
Oh, out of the 4, you need another,
because
there are animal pathogens
as well. That's right.
And then I come back to my original entry point. Yeah. Do another shower.
So 3 shower minimum if you have been to the BSL-4,
right?
And then you come out. So each layer, we say, is a pressure difference as well. The whole building is a box within a box.
Right.
So the pressure changes, the innermost has the lowest pressure.
Right.
So after you do the chemical shower, you take off your, clothes, you do a shower, and come to the BSL sort of 2-3 area.
Right.
And then you go to the really the outside world, you have to do another shower.
Yeah, and so we showered not too long ago here. We're really clean and ready to go.
Yeah.
It reminds me of my experience at Plum Island. Mm. So in this BSL-3, there are areas to work on highly pathogenic viruses. Well, what could you work on in the BSL-3, for example?
Well, for example, HIV, Japanese encephalitis virus, and in other countries, SARS are BSL-3, but Australia, we did not have a single human case. So when we apply for importation from the government, they put a condition to say we had to work on the BSL-3. four. SARS. Okay. You know, so yeah, but in other countries, SARS will be BSS-3. Yeah.
And in the BSL-4, what kind of viruses would you work on there?
We have almost the whole collection of the recent emergent viruses, right? So, you know, we start with Hendra virus, and then we had the Nipah Malaysia, and then the Nipah Bangladesh, of course. And then we have Ebola, Marburg virus, and then we had the SARS virus, and more recently the MERS virus, both from human and the camel.
Okay. Yeah. And any future pathogen that's human considered a BSL-4, you'll be able to work on it in there as well?
I mean, we can work on any pathogens. It's just, you know, our expertise in this sort of area, okay, and especially sure. with bat-borne sort of BSL-4 pathogens, because our history to start with Hendra virus and went into Corona, SARS, and MERS virus. Yeah.
And you also have the ability to work with animals in this facility, yeah. both 3 and 4 or just 4?
Any from Anything. two to four, basically 2, 3, 4. You know, because the building is designed to the highest specification. So that's what I try to differentiate between PC and the BSL. So physical containment, that's a PC. Okay, PC. The whole building is PC4, basically.
Right.
Okay. Every room, in theory, can convert into a BSL-4 operation, but we operate the whole complex at 3 different levels. Some are at the biosafety level 2, some are at the biosafety level 3, and some are at the biosafety level 4. Yeah.
Okay.
And in terms of the animals we can handle, I think this is, you know, because it was built as the Australian Animal Health Laboratory, so the animal facility is unique in the biocontainment facility, you know, over the world, is that we can handle small animals to live and larger animals. So just give you the exotic animals, you know, we have done. We have done macro bats, the rhinorphus, which is like 5 to 7 grams.
That would, you know, this would be right here?
Yeah, this is one of the macro bat, you know, it's a specimen.
Wow.
Yeah, and it's very small. And then we can go all the way to like the Hendra vaccine trial in BSF4, we have horses.
Wow.
You know. And I was joking about we can handle everything except maybe giraffe and an elephant.
You know? Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's quite impressive.
I mean, in theory, you want to do tiger and the lion, we can do it because the facility is large enough. You know?
So is this unique in that sense that you can do this wide range of animals?
Yes, I think the animal facility, we are certainly the largest in biocontainment facility all around the world. Yeah.
It's amazing. Yeah, and then yeah. I had the opportunity yeah. to look at some of the yeah. engineering space, which yeah. is amazing.
Oh, yeah. yeah. Yeah.
The number of HEPA filters.
Yeah, that's right. We have more than 1,000 HEPA filters in this
wow.
facility.
Which filter the air in yeah. and out, right?
Yeah, that's right. And just give you the sort of appreciation, because the filters has to be maintained by testing or replaced mm-hmm. twice a year. So we have 4 engineer staff. Their full-time job is testing and maintain, because by the time you finish the last one, right, you have to start the
over.
Cycle again.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's,
yeah
right.
that's right. Yeah.
Well, we were having a discussion yeah. at lunch. So we should say that in this, yeah. so this lab is a huge concrete
box
and mm-hmm. within it is another box, which is the yeah. 4-3.
Yeah.
So the both 3 and 4 is another concrete
that's
box.
That's right,
within
yeah.
it. And within that, there are also exercise rooms and lunch
yeah.
rooms.
Yeah.
And there's even a window on one side.
Yeah.
So people have space to move
yeah.
around.
So this is, I think, the design feature that no other BSS-3, because as I said, the whole operation is considered BSS-3 inside once you go in and you change your clothes. But because we designed that way, so people will spend the whole day basically, you know, inside, so that we actually, you know, design in the sort of area that you can have lunch,
right,
and you have toilet inside, of course. And then we also have a little bit of sort of exercise and entertainment area, you know,
yeah,
so you can play
yeah.
table tennis or go to the gym.
That's
so
great.
Which is very, very unique, yeah, inside a BSS-3 environment, yeah.
So, yeah, this, I was having lunch with yeah. Some of the people who work here, and I was talking about the controversy we're having mm-hmm. in the U.S. about the idea that these facilities are, mm-hmm. you know, they're not safe because we're all human and we mm-hmm. make mistakes. And someone said, it is safe. It's absolutely safe because he works here
yeah,
and
yeah,
he knows.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think you can't really understand
yeah,
how
yeah.
how safe it is until you come
yeah.
inside and work in it.
Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit about yeah. these guys. Now, my view of you is you're Dr. Bat now.
Yeah, that's
and in
what
fact, I saw a sign
yeah,
in
yeah,
your
yeah.
lab called the Bat Pack.
Bat Pack, yeah.
Which
yeah.
which might be the
yeah, yeah.
title for this episode. What yeah. got you interested in in bats.
Yeah. So everything in my life, as you say, you know, as I told you, is fate. I believe in Chinese. A lot of Chinese believe in fate, and I used not to believe, but like I did not plan to do biology, but I end up to do, you know, as a biochemist. And then I never thought of doing infectious disease. Then I end up in Geelong doing a lot of virus, and then, you know. And then Hanjo, of course, was the first killer virus to emerge in Australia, and in collaboration with scientists in Queensland, really, you know, that was a tremendous that 18 months after discovery of Hanjo, we have enough evidence to say it's a bat virus, not a human or horse virus. You know, I mean, if you were following the initial events because the emergent, because of the horse death and the vet, and you know, the horse trainer died, and then eventually the virus was isolated. So initially in the science paper was given a name of an equine mobility virus. And at that time I was not involved. And then later I as the molecular virologist, I went in to sequence the genome and I said, definitely not close to mobility virus.
Which is a paramyxo virus.
Yeah, it is a paramyxo in the family, but it's not like close enough to be in the genus of mobility virus. So when we had a full genome sort of we proposed to the ICTV, and at that time Nipah virus was also isolated. So we have two members that are close related, but not cross-react with any of the known other members of paramyxovirus. So we proposed the name of Hanipovirus, which is Hanjo and Nipah.
Right.
And so ICTV accepted that. So this is a new genus now. And so this is really the first exposure of bats. You know, as I said, I did not like biology, did not like zoology or botany. I chose to do biochemistry. So so it's the virus led me to bats, okay? And then I was going through the older literature of saying, you know, now you have two killer paramyxovirus from bats, whether there have been any report. And then we found in India, in Brazil, they have anecdotal evidence of other paramyxovirus isolated from bats. And then in Australia, we had another virus called a meningovirus, which emerged a few years later. It went from bats to pig to human. So the abattoir works got sick but not killed.
Right.
And then we identified the tumor virus in sort of Malaysia. But the real sort of interest really started is that the SARS outbreak. You know, Hanipah virus certainly, you know, was built in Australia, and you know, I really get into virology because of the Hanipah virus. But SARS was big, you know, SARS is much bigger than Hanipah. And then so the WHO was sort of after the sort of human pandemic, if it was under control, we still didn't know where the virus was from. You know, we knew that civets in the animal market in China play a role transmitting the virus to human. But I was the first one to demonstrate that civets is not the natural reservoir, because we can only detect antibodies of SARS or PCR. Civets already in the market.
Mm-hmm, not in the field.
Not in the farm. They supply the civets. So we conclude that cannot be a reservoir host. So John McKenzie, Australian virologist, you know, very well known, you know, he was succumbed to WHO to lead their, you know, scientific sort of advisor committee for SARS. And then, so they decided to assemble a special mission. As you know, that WHO does this a lot. They have a mission to go to the original country. So I was fortunate enough to be selected as the, you know, the only one who are not epidemiologists. The, all the other seven members, so we have an eight-member team. Seven are epi, sort of field, sort of infectious disease people.
Yeah.
I'm the only lab-based person. You know, and also because I came from China, so I have the advantage of speaking the language and know the politics and the culture a little bit better. So an eight-member team, we really worked hard from Beijing to, you know, Guangzhou to Shenzhen. That's where origin started. And during that trip, we did a lot of brainstorming. And I sort of made a bet to say, if I had the money, if Chinese scientists are willing to collaborate, the first species I would target is bats. And you know, after a few months of really diplomatic sort of negotiation and convincing, then we finally assembled a team of scientists, you know, two from Australia, two from China, one from US, and we started sampling bats. And the first time was negative, but the second field trip really paid off. We had an antibody evidence, and then eventually we got a three full-length genome. And so that's the closest, although it's not identical to human SARS virus, but that's the closest we can get.
These are horseshoe bats.
Horseshoe
right?
bats, yeah.
And recently an isolate has also
that's,
been...
Yes, I'm a co-author of that paper. Yeah. So the Dr. Zheng Lishi from Wuhan Institute of Virology was my... We collaborate, and we have been collaborating for more than 10 years, because when we first detect this, you know, I mean, and after that, of course, there's so many coronavirus have been detected, sequences have been detected in bats all around the world, but not a single isolation. That really puzzled us, you know. Everybody tried, and then, so Gary Cranberry from my lab went to Wuhan, and he is a very experienced virologist, and so we optimized the isolation procedure.
So you talked about getting infectious virus, right?
That's right. So I told Zheng Li, you know, that I say, you know, anybody can do PCR. Yeah. Of course, you know, if the more you do, the more closer related virus you can find. But I say, as a virologist, eventually you had to prove and also to isolate real virus.
So I want to hear that again. So if you just do PCR, it doesn't prove that the infectious virus is there, right?
Well, I think it's not as strong, right? Because you can say, and nowadays people even questioning whether it's a mechanical transfer, you know, from bat pool, right?
Sure.
Whether you just go through the, even contamination from environment can get into the bat, the fecal material. So I think that either you isolate live virus or you have a full-length genome plus a lot of serology. If you have a lot of serology data, that's, you know, that would be good. The sequence alone, I personally don't think that's, it's subjective. Like our science paper in 2005 would suggest SARS could be potentially the reservoir of SARS-like, the bats could potentially be the SARS-like virus is we have three full-length genome and plus 29% seropositive.
Right.
If it's only sequence alone, I don't think we will get to the science, you know.
Okay. So that got you full tilt into bats, basically.
That's right.
And then since we've had now, what other viruses have come out? Well, many people have done virus discovery programs.
Yeah.
They find lots of viruses in bats.
Oh, yeah. Then you cover everything. Hepatitis B, C, and Hunter virus, flu A, of course, the CDC paper. And then, you know, more recently is the Bunyan virus. So, you know, in China, they have this severe sort of fever with cytopenia. So the about 2009, I mean, that's quite a few deaths as well. And then that led to the discovery of the heartland virus in USA. Initially, it was two ICU cases and survived, and recently they have two deaths being associated. And in Japan and South Korea, even up to this 2014, they had still people dying from that. And we just published a paper in EID that we had a virus in Australia isolated from albatross. So it's a wild bird on Tasmania Island. And it's close related to these guys. Mm-hmm. So now we have a similar sort of new Bunyan virus isolated from three continents, Asia, USA, and Australia. But interestingly, that there's a group in India was looking for Nipah virus in bats. So they were doing virus isolations. And so this is a good example. Nipah has been detected in Indian bats, but has not had any virus isolation.
Okay.
Same with Bangladesh.
Right.
So they were trying to do a live virus isolation. They did not get Nipah, they got a Bunyan virus.
Yeah.
Okay, so that virus now is related to the killer virus in Asia and the USA.
So the Asian, the US cases were tick-borne, right?
Yeah, tick-borne.
So the
virus Chinese
is going
are tick-borne as
from
well.
Bats to ticks?
This is too early to say, but I'm just, trying to illustrate that even this very newly isolated tick-borne sort of virus, there is a cross-cousin in bats.
Of course, there are a lot of paramyxoviruses in bats.
Oh, paramyxovirus, you know, and
herpes.
Oh, herpes is everywhere. Adenovirus. We have more bat adenovirus than I can handle.
How about picornaviruses?
Yes, picornavirus as well.
And retroviruses?
The retroviruses, yes. There are a lot of sequences, and we try to, you know, Gilda, you know, you just talked to her, and I'm collaborating with Gilda and try to look into retrovirus because I'm not a retrovirologist. I have too many projects already, but I'm collaborating with a lot of people.
So there's endogenous retroviruses in the sequence of the bat genome. So not too long ago, you published two bat genome sequences. Those are the first bat genomes?
Yeah, these are the first sort of detail, the bat genome. So we did the comparison. So really coming back to my interest in bats, as I said, I'm not a bat biologist. I'm a bat virologist. So about, 5 years ago, 2008, now almost 6 years ago, you know, we did a really brainstorming within my group and made a decision to say that a lot of questions being asked are why bats?
Right.
You know, why they carry so many viruses. And in the BSF-4, no matter which virus you challenge, very hard to have disease or even fever, okay?
Do they get infected even?
Yes, but not reproducibly.
So you can bring bats into the 4 and infect them. Do you do you breed them somewhere?
Yeah, that's one thing we don't have. And CDC now, I just came back from the infectious disease of bat meeting in Fort Collins. So CDC is, you know, ahead with the Rosetta's bats, and they have really good breeding colony.
Okay.
Yeah, and but anyway, so about 6 years ago, we made a decision to say, you know, I mean, we were doing pretty good with bat-borne viruses, but to understand the pathogen host relationship, mm-hmm. we really need to understand bats a little bit better. But if you look around, there's no reagent, there's no bat cell line, no bat IgM, IgG antibodies, there's no way you have can do bat T cell immunology, for example. So we say if we want to seriously study bats, then you know you have to make a hard decision. And nowadays, I think the genome sequence is almost indispensable if you want to go deeper. So, you know, again, learned the lesson from my first sort of SARS research. I go out and begging and I try to convincing people to collaborate. So eventually, again, we did a large consortium, you know, two US group, one Australian, two Chinese group, and we come together. So we sequenced two bats. One is the flying fox, mm-hmm. the Australian large flying fox, the reservoir hendrovirus, and Myotis davidii, which is an important genus sort of in macro bats, but also is a known reservoir of viruses in China.
It's about this size bat?
Yeah. So bat. This is a similar size. And so we sequenced two bat genome, and then is a comparative sort of genomics to really to address a few questions. One is that bat biologists has been debating for the last century about the evolution of bats. Two questions, you know, what's the closest mammal related to bats? Secondly, whether the two suborders, the large and the small bats, they independently evolved to acquire fly capability or they had a common ancestor. Mm-hmm. So that's a pretty important question. And so I think we resolved that from the genome study that we can, you know, identify common ancestor about 190 to 100 million years ago, and then they diverged about 80 million years ago to the two, insectivores versus the flying fox, yeah.
So what else do you learn from the genome sequence of bats?
Yeah, so I think is the most interesting and pleasantly surprising lesson we learned from bats is that we went into looking for features of immunity to do with the infection. But we found that the most positive selected genes are all to do with the DNA damage repair pathways. Mm-hmm. So this is sort of, you know, in retrospect, it makes sense because as the only flying mammal, their metabolic rate is very different. Like hibernating bats, for example, their heartbeat is 6 beats per minute during during hibernation. But when they wake up and go to fly out for food, goes over 1,000 beats per minute.
Wow.
So you have to have a way to handle not only the anatomy, the heart structure and the blood circulation, but also the byproduct of the metabolism, right?
Right.
So one of them is, of course, the oxidative stress.
Mm-hmm.
And so we thought that makes sense. So we started thinking of that way and how to really link with all the other features. So the other features that of bats, one of them is longevity. Bats has a 3 to 10 times longer lifespan of mammal of similar size. Now, you know, I'm not a really sort of expert in this area, but since then I started reading papers about the theory of aging. So, which species can live longer? Mm-hmm. There's two main characters. One is body size for mammals, at least. One is your heartbeat. So, if you have a longer or you have a large mammal with a slow heartbeat, in theory, you will have a longer lifespan.
Like elephants.
Yeah. So bats like this guy, you know.
It's tiny.
5 grams, okay. So one of the myotis species is really 7 grams
mm-hmm.
and live 43 years, human years, 43.
How many bat years is
that? Yeah, I don't know how to calculate bat years. It would be over 1,000. If you use dog years, that's over 1,000, you know. So,
wow.
Okay, so, and they have so they're small size and a high sort of rate of heartbeat. So they defy sort of the fear of aging in both accounts, you know. So we were really excited when we saw this DNA damage repair as the main sort of, and now in the last 5 years, of course, you see this crosstalking of the key sensing molecules in DNA damage, also sensing innate immunity, inflammation, apoptosis.
Sure.
And then mitochondria is like the key. Sort of my high school biology says mitochondria is the energy sort of organelle, but now more and more it says it's also command center. is sensing different signals and make a decision, say, do I fight or do I commit suicide and die with the pathogen?
Okay.
So it all makes sense, you know.
And what you mentioned tumorigenesis. They don't have a lot of tumors, right?
You see, this is, I have to say, it's anecdotal because you go through literature, you put in bats in a cancer, you will get maybe, you know, six papers, you know, be lucky. The other is that, remember, we were really sort of limited with cell lines. So I was really writing to all the bat biologists around the world, say, you know, can you provide tumor tissues or have you seen tumors in your life dealing with bats? And the most people said very rare, very hard to find tumors. So, but that's, I have to say, anecdotal, whereas lifespan, I think, is scientifically proven. Yes.
So then, how does this help you understand the well, so bats have lots of viruses. Mm-hmm. They don't seem to be sick, right? And you said in the lab, it's hard to get them sick.
Yeah.
How do you investigate that? What's the approach?
Yeah, so what we're doing right now is both sort of, I mean, animal trials is difficult for two reasons. One is that, you know, sourcing bats is not easy and some of them protected. Secondly is that I think the lesson we learned is that if you don't know the genetic and infectious history of the bats, it's all, you know, our breed and the white coat. So one thing we try to do is, of course, establish a breeding colony first. To you know, so that's what I say. You know, CDC and other groups that are ahead of us in terms of they already have a breeding colony.
But you're working on that, right?
Yeah. So what I'm also interested is now to really go through the molecular and the cellular mechanism to look at this theory of that DNA damage repair, innate immunity, and everything is really maybe there's something that as a flying mammal, there could be some subtle difference. So when we went to the genome sequencing, I was thinking of two possibilities. One is that there's a major pathways that bats have we used to have, but we don't use anymore, or there are pathways that we have bats don't have, and that they behave differently. I mean, you know, so far the genome says, you know, subtle difference, there's no major difference. The second possibility is that although, for example, you know, interferon alpha is very different. Human, we have, you know, 13, 14 subtype between human and mouse, the alpha, interferon alpha.
Right.
In the whole bat genome, we only identify three, and most likely two of them are not active, only one. So there is some sort of major difference already.
But in the opposite direction of what you predict, right? Because if bats are resistant or...
May or may not, actually. Because if you think of that when you have a fine tuning, you have more, right? Mm-hmm. And then you can be more effectively to eliminate a bat virus. Whereas, so I think, you know, I always try to really emphasize the difference between, says, you know, some people thinking bats are very efficient in clear the virus. I said, no, bats, that harbors the virus, but does not develop symptoms.
So at a population level,
these
bats have many, many different viruses at any given time.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah.
Through that for the whole life of the bat, pretty much?
We don't know because, you know, we haven't done longitudinal. Yeah. I'll give you one example is that 2011, we had so many Hendra outbreaks in Brisbane. So we went to sample the bat urine because paramyxoviruses are mainly shed from urine samples. Okay, so what we do is we put a clean plastic sheet after, you know, dark, and then the bats will come, they goes up. And the first thing that comes in is, you know, they drop, you know, urine and fecal. So we take fresh urine drops. So, I mean, it's hard to say that one job is from one animal, but most of the jobs is from one animal, right? You may splash and contaminate a little bit.
Yeah.
From one urine job, we isolate five live virus, real virus,
infectious
not sequence,
viruses,
infectious virus.
Wow.
You know?
I guess you could look at DNA and see if it's one bat or multiple bats too, right?
Yeah. One is the species, and then the other is the gender, and then the individual. So we can look at the sort of a SNP, you know.
Okay, so it's clear that at a population level, there are lots of viruses for long periods, and that remains to be sorted out at the individual level. But so you're saying that maybe a reduced immune system is responsible for that, and maybe there's less immunopathology as a result.
That's exactly our hypothesis, and we have preliminary data to suggest or support that. Is that so? You know, the interferon story again, the alpha is a really good story because what we're seeing is that it has a high base level,
right?
But when you stimulate with poly-IC or you infect with a virus, they go maybe only one log high rather than in humans from 0 to 7 logs.
Right. Yeah.
So our current hypothesis is that it comes from the DNA damage because they are so constantly exposed to threat.
Yeah.
You know, as I talked at the ASM meeting, you know, it's like a defense, you know, your country defense. Now you have an external invasion and internal terrorism or whatever. So cell phasing was two things as well. It can be an infection from outside. It can be a reactive oxidative species damage your DNA. That's an equally important threat. So if you can have a same commander center to fight both threats, it makes sense, right?
Sure.
So we think that bats have a threat in terms internally because they are high metabolic rate and oxidative stress. They are under more threat than, you know, another mammal of low metabolic rate. Mm-hmm. Secondly is that there are sort of flying mammals, they're going to more sort of environment, exposed for more pathogens more rapidly. Secondly, most of the bats, not all of them, I have to, you know, really be careful saying that, because most bats live really high density. Mm-hmm. So again, they are prone to infections attack. So maybe you have a double selection there. So to make their system, the DNA damage, innate immunity, inflammation, is that what they have is they have a high base level. So if the virus comes in, they dampen you, but they don't go overboard to kill you so that they don't have, or they have less chance of immunopathology.
Okay.
That's our working model or hypothesis right now.
So one way to study this is to take a bat and infect it and measure the interferon response.
Yes.
And see not just the interferons, but also the, I presume bats have interferons,
of course,
stimulated genes,
yeah.
And they have as many as other mammals do?
We haven't really profiled all of them right now, so we are going for, it's like the bat microRNA, bat ISGs, of course majority were shared with other mammals, but they do have a few bat specific ones we're most interested.
So you'd want to look at the expression of those infection with different viruses, and this is in whole bats, right?
We're doing cell level and the whole bats as well. So we want to do cell level first so that we have some handle of the reagent development, and then we'll go to whole bats,
And so right now, before you have a colony, you have to get bats.
That's right.
So they're captured from Australia, from other places as well?
Because we have invested so much, I mean, that's another, you know, thing we, at the bat symposium, we always discuss that, you know, bats are not the same. We have over 1,000 species, right. So which one you choose, right?
Yes.
I said for us, you know, in Australia, the choice is simple because we will have to choose the major reservoir hangiovirus. You know, one is a national interest, and one is funding. And the other practical reason is that these guys, the microbats, are much harder to handle in a BSF4 environment because they are insectivorous bats. We have done two challenging experiments for SARS, and I think my technician will never do that again because these guys, you know, to keep them alive in BSF4 is a challenge. Mm-hmm. Because we don't have, of course, insects to fly inside BSF4 for them to naturally eat. So what we did is that we have this, you know, the worms, you know, the small, so they're still alive, and we fly with a, you know, forceps fly in front of them to train them.
Really?
And then eventually they know how to eat it, but we had to do that twice a day for each bat, you know. And it's a lot of work.
Of course, so sampling is also a challenge.
Yeah, right? So the large black flying fox, you know, so this is the cover of the science, you know, for the genome, mm-hmm. is that these guys are fluke bats. So all you have to have tropical mango, bananas, and have waters, and they're happy they can, you know, and also, you know, when you sample them, you know, blood is one thing that in the SARS studies, we were dealing with, you know, our Chinese collaborators, you know, the most they can give me is 5 microliters per individual.
Wow, 5 microliters. Yeah. So you get actually good at developing assays.
Yeah, so we now, the serology is all Luminex-based, so it's highly sensitive. In theory, all we need is, you know, 0.5 microliter mm-hmm. less we can do, and then we do multiplex across different bat pathogens.
Yeah. How big is the fruit bat?
These guys, the body weight is around go up to 1 kilogram. And the wingspan is 80 to centimeter, 1 meter.
And so this is also a challenge in a BSL-4 because it's rather large, right?
Yeah, so from the animal ethics point of view, that I think we won't be allowed them to fly because that will cause more damage.
Yeah.
So we have to build these cages large enough for them to move around,
but
you know, to have social activities, but small enough for them to feel like they cannot fly.
Don't you worry, though, that without the high oxidative levels of flight, that you might be biasing?
We just discussed that because, you know, recently there's a review paper in EID thinking that the daily flight cause a febrile, like it's not a pathogenic sort of a febrile, but it cause a temperature increase. And then so they hypothesize that may also be important to maintain the virus load at low level. So this is artificial. So we bat virologists already discussed this, but I don't think we have any practical way to solve that.
You'd have to build a huge facility.
For this guy to fly, you know, but then you have the biosecurity issue, right? Because if you build an outdoor facility, allow them to fly with a large cage, and how you, for example, prevent tick and mosquitoes to transmit a virus to these guys during...
Very difficult. Yeah. So, you know, it just occurred to me, you know, many people have studied bats over the years. They don't get any attention. But now that you do viruses in bats, it's a big deal because people love viruses.
Yeah. You know? So this is a plus or minus for me as a bat virologist because on one hand, I'm helping bat biologists. Yeah. For example, we determine the genome, you know.
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
So we have a love-hate relationship. I was joking about because they love us because we now put bats at a high sort of importance and we do genomics. But at the same time, they hate us because we keep discovering these nasty viruses. So the public really think, you know, bats as evil and all the sources of deadly viruses. So I have to emphasize, you know, I hope your listeners also, you know, pay attention to this, is I always say it's not bats' fault. Bats has been with this virus for millions
of
years.
Of course.
It's really the, you know, disturbance of their habitat and the recent farming practice, you know, all this climate change, for example. You know, the flying fox is interesting. These black guys in Australia, they used to be on the Northern Territory, sort of more the northern borders of Australia. And then, you know, Hendra would not have happened 100 years ago because Hendra is a suburb of Brisbane.
Right.
100 years ago, we did not have a black flying fox there. You know, they came down, you know, the last 50 years.
Right, and then, well, that's part of, you know, so the urbanization,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, urbanization, and we think it's the warming of the continent, you know.
Are you also interested in the antibody and cellular responses of bats?
Yes. So, you know, I was fortunate enough after I went to Singapore and headed the EID program, and over there, so they have a basic research called the National Research Foundation. So I got a multi-million dollar large grant, and the title of the grant is Learning from Bats, you know, from controlling viral infection to combating cancers, you know.
Right.
So in that program, I'm the leading PI, and I have five, you know, co-PIs. They are leading sort of scientists in dendritic cells, B T cell immunity, innate immunity, structural biologists, and a tumor suppressor. Suppression expert. So we are looking at the whole spectrum of this. I mean, the project just started this year. Of course, we're early stages, a five-year program.
And this is all new because you don't know how, have no idea how bats respond with antibodies, cellular immunity, all the other immune cells, right?
That's right.
I mean, you're basically learning an organism.
Yeah.
And of course, you're going to learn one or two out of the thousand species,
that's
right?
That's exactly right. But the thing is that, you know, people sometimes say, okay, bats or birds fly as well. Why don't you study birds? And birds have been studied more extensively than bats, you know?
Yeah.
And of course, my counter argument is one is because the virus I'm dealing with is a bat born. But secondly, I said, I'm really trying to learn something from bats because they're mammals. I'm still hoping there's something from bats if we can learn and then, you know, translate at least to livestock through transgenic animal or to humans through, you know, gene therapy or you know, modulations of certain key master regulators.
Absolutely.
You know?
Well, of course.
So that's the dream.
The birds get studied for influenza,
that's right?
Yeah. Because they're a huge. The water birds are a huge reservoir. They get plenty of attention for
that's
that.
Right. Yeah.
So, but what you said, I wanted to actually ask whether we can learn things to maybe eventually make us more resistant.
Yeah, that certainly is the whole basis of this multi-million dollar grants from Singapore is learning from bats.
So I wanted to ask you about MERS, which has been found in camels, and it looks like it goes from camels to people.
Humans, yeah.
Do you think it originally was in a bat?
Well, I mean, as you know, I'm biased. I would think like that because the SARS story, for example, when we publish it in Science, people say, "Oh, this is a different virus. It does not use the ACE. It did not use ACE2 receptor."
Right.
So it took us 10 years of intensive surveillance and the virus isolation trial. Finally, we got that Nature paper. You know, Dr. Shi from Wuhan Institute of Virology was the main corresponding author. So 10 years to get another virus from bats that use the ACE2 receptor. So I guess, you know, it's possible, but it's too early to say whether bats is the reservoir. I think even if bats the reservoir, they may have donated virus a long time ago to camel or another animal. You know, I'm not sort of doing a lot of enough epidemiology in Middle East, but I think of talking from the people who are involved to say at least half the cases cannot be explained because they don't have direct contact to camels. So camel could be the one of the animals donating, and there could be other sort of routes of transmission of the virus to human population.
But in bats, there have been related viruses to MERS,
quite
right?
A few related viruses, that's true. Yeah. And so, all over the world as well. I mean, the first one was from Hong Kong, you know, so it's very, you know, far away from Middle East.
So do you still do environmental sampling of bats?
Myself don't, because I consider myself, you know, our group in Geelong at least is really lab-based and biocontainment is our strength. But I have collaboration all over the world, you know, so when people says, can you help with the samples? And then so we, one thing I think, you know, for virologists, you know, especially in sort of for their natural reservoir and study zoonosis, the trendy way of doing it is people just collect sample in a PCR. I have always been advising people to say, yes, you can do that, it's easy, that's why everybody's doing it, but it'll be more rewarding if you can really actually bother to develop specific serologic test. Because our Hanjo experience will tell us, and also the SARS, you know, the SARS-like coronavirus in China, is that the first hint came from serology. Because, you know, Hanjo we have been studying for the last 20 years, you know, under sort of a normal season, we don't know what triggers the outbreak season, you know. The normal season, if you go there, if you want to use PCR, you'll be lucky to detect with 1-3%. So most of the people sample like 50 bats. So by default, even the virus is harbored by bats, the PCR won't reveal it. With serology is different, like Hanjo in Queensland, it goes from 10-60%. So yeah, so I encourage people who are interested in, you know, virus in reservoir species, really pay a bit more attention into the serology.
Now you were telling me earlier that there's a bat colony nearby.
That's right.
What kind of bats are these?
Yeah, so these we have four different species of flying foxes. So the black one is the in northern part in you know, Queensland, and we have this the gray sort of headed flying fox. And so they, you know, if you look at their genome, if you, you know, some of the genes we have sequenced, they're 98-99% identical. And they also carry the antibody to Hanjo virus, but we have not been able to detect even by PCR.
Any Hanjo virus?
Yeah, and we had tried live virus isolation, we could not. So this is another thing about fascinating about bats is if you have a rodent population, if you have this kind of seroprevalence, usually if you try hard, especially with PCR, you should be able to at least detect some nucleic acid. But for bats, sometimes, you know, they're transmitting, obviously, right, because of the seroprevalence and you know, the population is dynamic. But to get virus is very difficult, you know, all the nucleic acid,
So this bat colony that you study, you just look for Hendra, nothing else in those? Is that
no,
right?
No, no. We actually looking at all parameters. So what we have started about 3 years ago is that, you know, so this is another story, as I said, you know, we have the world's largest biocontainment facility here. And so this is start operation 85. And then around 88, a few bats come here and if they like it, start to colonize there.
And amazing.
Then I 88, 89, so I joined the lab end of 1990. And 94, we found the Hendra virus. 96, we say it's a bat virus. So it's like almost a fate again, you know, the theme of fate. So I said, you know, as the world's largest biocontainment group and the world's largest bat virology group, you know, we should really take advantage of the colony next door. Although we haven't been able to isolate Hendra virus, we said, let's do longitudinal samples. Because, you know, to our luck is that the paramyxovirus from bats, the main route of shedding is urine. So bats, if you want to catch them, sample them, it's quite demanding. Right, we know they carry a lot of virus. So what we're doing is non-invasive sampling, basically put a plastic sheet and then sample urine and a fecal sample. So we can do large numbers and we can do frequently.
You leave the sheet overnight,
right? Yeah, overnight,
right?
Yeah. So we are doing this weekly basis we have been doing for the last 3 years.
Wow.
And then from time to time, we also capture a few bats and get serum samples and then release, of course. So what we're trying to find is that really looking for the drivers for the what we call spike of virus. Like the Queensland story says, although initially we were only targeting Hendra virus, but the Hendra sort of for spike season, we found that we can more easily isolate other paramyxovirus, virus, adenovirus, or even, you know, herpes virus. So we're working on a hypothesis that might be that certain triggers, we don't know what the triggers at a population level,
right,
that you triggers the whole bat population shed more virus.
Yeah.
So in the Geelong sort of a colony, we're doing this. And of course, you know, we are also measuring, for example, in the cortisol level to say whether stress is involved. And so far, you know, there's a little bit seasonality, there's a little bit cortisol, but I don't think we can draw a strong conclusion say that that's the trigger.
Okay.
You know, so we I sort of try to be careful is that we take the samples and we aliquot them. I say, you know, wait until the technology catches up so we can do a discovery approach.
It always does.
Yeah, metabolites in urine, for example, you know.
It's a, so, metabolite detection is incredible.
Yeah.
In fact, if it's still light, we're going to go
look
at this colony.
Yeah, that's right. I'm just hoping that we can.
So I won't keep you much longer. So I just have a few more questions for today.
Yeah.
Besides infecting bats, you're also interested in other animals as hosts for these viruses. So you do some studies in mice, is that right?
Yeah. We have, of course, you know, the mice, for example, Hendra, we just had a, you know, after many years trial, we have a really good model that we can reproducibly sort of establish a neurological infection model. And we, ferrets is a very important model for Hendra virus, you know, and Hendra, you know, the flu group uses really. And then, of course, for the vaccine trials in horses, then we have to do actually in horses, you know. And we have pigs as well for Nipah and Ebola restaurant, for example, WHO, and we collaborate with CDC, and we did that trial here to put the Ebola restaurant virus back to pigs.
So as a vaccine candidate, because it's
no,
not
No. We just want to see the disease that observed in Philippines.
That's right. Yeah. Yes.
So we, at least the challenger studies here says, you know, Ebola restaurant alone did not cause any disease symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, you know, the PWIS, which was co-infecting,
right.
I think maybe more responsible to disease. So it's kind of interesting.
So there is a Hendra vaccine in development, and you tested it here?
It's already licensed.
It's licensed.
Yeah, so it's the first licensed vaccine against any BSF4 agent. So it's a One Health approach, because we developed a vaccine that vaccinate horses. So one is, especially some of the really expensive racing horses, you know.
Yeah.
So you save horses, but more importantly, you prevent that transmission from bat to horse to human.
So all the transmissions of Hendra were from horse to human,
so
right?
far, yes. Horse, human. Yeah, the seven sort of confirmed transmission to humans are all from horses, and all from sick horses, and a human has to have a very close contact.
Now, in the case of Nipah, you immunize pigs, and that will prevent pig human, but there's also some bat human. Right?
Yeah, this is in Malaysia. In Bangladesh, there was no sort of livestock involvement. It's direct bat to human transmission. So this is going to be much more difficult. And also, plus the developing nations, you know, vaccination against a disease that kills a few people a year, I don't think it is going to happen.
Would the MERS vaccine for camels be a One Health? It doesn't make camels sick, does it?
Yes, but it still be useful to make them not transmitting. So
So
actually, at the bat sort of conference in Fort Collins, you know, Vincent Munster's group in Rocky Mountain is already had one trial, and so they are really already trying to learn from the Hendra's experience to develop a One Health vaccine for MERS vaccinate camels.
You know, in fact, while I was there, they offered to show me the camels. Because they were there in Fort Collins.
That's right. That's right.
They were going to show me, but I didn't have a chance.
Now he's leading a very active group, you know, doing really good work there. Yeah.
Pretty exciting, isn't it?
Of course.
Do you love this? Do you love all this bat virology?
Of course, you know, so this is the thing, right? This is the thing, it's like a cycle. I start with hating biology. If I had a choice in Shanghai in 78, right? If they say, you know, I cannot do engineer, I may be doing law or arts more than biology. Biology was at the bottom of my, you know, preference if I was gonna choose at all.
Yeah.
But now, you know, with all this exciting science, and especially, you know, at my career stage, I'm thinking one is my own science. The other more exciting is I helped the junior and the PhD student, postdoc, to excite them and to get them into the right track. And you know, in the whole batch sort of virus host, DNA damage repair, tumor, innate immunity, inflammation, I think it's really exciting. So I'm excited in the sense that, that I can help these people, and also hopefully then we can find something really interesting from bats and eventually have some translational, you know, application to livestock and human. Yeah.
Well, we've done a couple of your papers on TWiV already, and I'm
thank you for that.
I have a feeling we're going to be doing a lot more.
Yeah, that's in the future. Certainly we hope. You know, and then, you know, I have a lot of students and postdocs are, you know, your fans. So we were really happy that you accept our invitation to come here to visit the biocontainment facility.
I am really grateful that you took the time, and I learned a lot today. I actually had a great time in Australia.
That's
I met a lot of great virologists, and I really made some new friends. And I think this, I mean, so much of virology is really exciting today, but this is like a frontier because we don't know anything about these little bats.
That's right, that's what excites me. You know, as I said, you know, biology itself, I was not interested enough, but now, I'm in this pioneer area, you know. So how I encourage my students is to say, it's going to be more difficult than human and the mouse immunology, but I said, everything you do, you'll be the first in the world.
Yep.
That's the thing, you know. You know, you gain some, you lose some.
But makes it easier to motivate people, right?
Yes,
a lot
that's
easier.
Right,
that's right.
Yeah.
Well, let's go. Let's go look at some bats.
Yeah,
this episode of TWiV will be found at twiv.tv and also on iTunes. If you have any questions for us, as always, send them to twiv@twiv.tv. And Linfa Wang, my guest today, is at the Australian Animal Health Laboratory in Geelong, Australia. Thanks so much for talking with me today.
Thank you, Vincent, for coming by, and I really enjoy your visit.
And I'm Vincent Racaniello. You can find me at virology.ws. You've been listening to This Week in Virology. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back next week. Another TWiV is viral.
Of the noise will go gradually more frequent, and everybody almost like is screaming, you know, they get excited. Now some already start moving, see? Yeah, so in that, so 2011, the Queensland, my students and technicians, they collect 37 drops of really good quality urines. We made 47 live virus isolation, 47,
wow.
You know.
Wow. Just by putting the urine on cells, right?
Yeah. There's one here.
Oh. How they turn around, huh?
Yeah. These are younger ones you can see, you know, this one, little one. So maybe get excited, but the parent says no, not yet. Yeah.
The smell of urine, is that them?
Yeah, I think so.
Wow.
Yeah, they're very smelly animals, yeah. So we're always joking about, you know, you can just hope they don't drop something into your eye or mouth and get an inoculation, you know.
Yeah.
But that way, we really believe some of the hendra transmission happened there because there's a few horse cases, right? They don't have trees near the stable.
Yeah.
So they don't have colony, you know, constantly live nearby, but maybe flying over, just dropping, you know, if you're unlucky. And also, what you need is super shedder. Because the bat population overall don't shed enough virus for transmission.
Right.
Or you need one individual that day, have a, oh, now, you see?
Yeah, now
right,
there's more.
It's coming, yeah, okay. Beautiful, so we catch the right time.
It's perfect, like your career, this is perfect, right?
Yeah. Yeah, did not include a slide I normally use is, you know, bats in Western cultures is a dark evil, but in Chinese it means fortune.
Really?
So I say, you know, my scientific fortune took off since I studied bat virus, you know.
Makes sense.
Yeah. Wow, now you have the big and small guys all coming. The amazing thing is they start to fly, right? They don't fly out, they circle.
Yeah.
Until they go, then they all go. Wow. That'd be wonderful. You can sort of editing a few grabs off of flying bats.
Yeah, definitely. I'll edit it into the TWiV for sure. Yeah. Yeah.
That's what I feel, you know, confident I can attract visitors because you see the largest bar containment and then you see a bat colony as well, you know, you won't flirt. No other place in the world you can have birds, you know.
Yeah.
Wow, look at that. Now it's really coming out.